Hi, I'm Ben Rajesh from Mechanical Department. We're going to see about the Toolmakers Microscope and how it is going to helpful for measuring a small equipments in the mechanical field. Okay, let us start with the reason behind the name of this equipment. The name of this equipment is called as profile projector. It has the two words, profile and projector. The profile of a small equipment can be projected in a huge screen, and we can able to take a measurement from the screen. So the word profile is exactly specify the profile which can be magnified here. And the second one, projector, can able to magnify your image for 10 times of your original image. The whatever you have it in your hand, it will be less than a centimeter, but that can be projected in a screen with 10 times of that. So you can able to easily measure that. So the reason behind this equipment is used for easy measurement. It will reduce the effort of the engineers to measure the equipment. This gear is called as a watch gear. It will be used in your wrist watches, and it can be measured to the high precise to have a accurate time in your wrist watch. So in order to control your time as well as your minute and second measurement, we have to control your tooth measurements, so that will be reflecting in your accuracy of your time. If suppose your gear tooth width was increased beyond your measurement and you can't able to manipulate that with your manufacturing equipment, then it will be reflected in your accuracy of your wristwatch. So to avoid that, we are having a highly sophisticated equipments which can able to tame your uneven in your manufacturing process. So that is the the significance of profile projector. It will be helpful for controlling the uncertainty in your manufacturing process by showing even a tiny errors which will be captured in the manufacturing process. Now we'll go to the measurement process, how we are going to measure the tiny equipment in the profile projector. So before that, I should say that how to operate the machine, then we can go for how to measure that. So we have first one is a main switch. When you press that, the entire light will be switched off. So that is the one point of switch which can able to either to lit your light or to switch off that light. So along with that, in the behind this equipment, we have two exhaust fans which will be running together along with this light to avoid the heat which will be generated, to avoid the storage of heat which will be generated inside the equipment. So if you run the machine, we don't need any extra or external equipment to chill this machine. So these two exhaust fans will be taking care of that. And after that, we have dim and bright light switches are there. When you dim it down, it will reduce the glareness which will be directly meeting with your eye. The other one is a high intensity bulb which will provide a maximum information which will be captured along your profile. The other one is a perpendicular light which will be coming across the exactly at 90 degree of your incidence. So what is the usage of that? If suppose take your 1 rupee coin and you want to know the thickness of the three-phased line, and you want to know that the surface thickness, then you can use this light. When you switch on that, that will be projected in the screen. So that is the use of that. I will show you in the later half of the equipment what is the significance of this perpendicular light. And the next one is the switch on or off for the parallel light which will be coming down from the bottom of your equipment. So these are all the three usage of this switches. And the fourth one, we have a zooming screw. What is the usage of that? This will push your table or pull your table so that you can reduce your distance towards your magnifying lens. We have a lens here. So basically we know that zooming is not just try to grow your equipment or try to see the huge equipment, but rather it will reduce the distance from your object towards your lens. When you reduce the distance, viewing distance, then your image will be seems to be grown beyond its size, as like your Doppler effect, what we have it in your railway station. When you see the railway train which is approaching you, it looks like a huge mammoth creature which was approaching you, but when it is moving out of your view, it seems to be like decreasing size. So it's just a visual perception. It's like it's called as a zooming or magnification. Based on your distance between your mobile object and the observer, when the distance is very small, the object seems to be grown to a huge size. But when it is moving beyond your visual perception, then it seems to be like a mini train, the same one which seems to be a larger one After it departs from your view, it seems to be like a smaller one. The same we are going to do here. We are trying to lift your table elevated to a certain height so that the small gear which is placing in the working table, which seems to be the larger one, okay, but when you try to move it down, what will happen? It try to reduce its size from the exact one. So that is happening here. So that we call it as a zooming process. So we have to locate the optimized distance so that you can get the exact, you know, the thickness of your outer fringe of your gear. So that is the function of your zooming screw. And after that, we have a two calipers here. This is called as a y-axis caliper and this is a x-axis caliper. What is the use of that? It's just a replacement of your the old age screw gauge. We have a screw gauge with a U-shape jaw which will be helpful for identifying the thickness or your round diameter of your any screw or rather your cylindrical object. So instead of that, we have a digital screw gauge here which will be taking care of all your measurements. Instead of taking your scale and pencil along with your calculator to measure your least count, main scale reading, vernier scale reading, this will avoid all such measurements. And you know, only thing is you have to revolve it to capture the reading. So it will take care of up to 3 decimal values. So you can see comfortably operate this machine without having worry about the accuracy of your values, because this machine can able to look after all these intelligent factors. So we have a 2 display here. The same value will be reflected here as well as the here. So this is just a mirror of these two the values. The same value what you capture it here, that will be reflected here also. So when you revolve it here, say for example, I'm revolving it here. Okay, so I'm aligning the vertical screw and I want to make this point as a zero. So I'm pressing the bean button here. When you press it down, the zero will be displayed here as well as it will be reflected here. So the user or the person who is unknown about the vernier caliper, I mean digital screw gauge, no need to bother about the value which is reflected on the small screen. He just has to look after this value and that will help him to identify these values. So first let us start with the how to measure the linear values, x-axis and y-axis values. So that will help you to understand how to measure it. And second one, we should also look after the angular measurements. We have an angular degree as well as in radian measurements. So in Asian part of the countries, we'll be measuring your angular values with the unit of degrees. But when you go to the Western countries, they'll be following the inches as a measurement. Inches for the linear measurement and radians for the angular measurement. But the Asian countries are following the SI unit, which will be measuring the linear values in millimeter, and the angular measurement in degrees. So that is the only change with respect to the measurement. But anyway, the same machine can able to measure both in Asian as well as the Western countries. You can able to toggle it between millimeter and inch. So in the first half of the video, we have seen about how the equipment is functioning. You know, we are looking about the functional view of your profile projector. And the second half, what we are going to see, about the method of measuring your instrument, the small miniature equipments on this profile projector. Okay, so you know, in the first half I have told you the features of this each buttons, what we have it in profile projector, and the magnification, how it is going to magnify, and the ratio of magnification is 10x. That also we have mentioned in the first half. In the second half, we are going to see how we are going to measure it down. Now we'll go for the measurement, how to measure it. And before that, I want to cover what all the equipments can be measured here. You know, say for example, anything which cannot be viewed by your naked eye, that can be measured. The best example, biological microscope, we have a small bacteria which was mixed with either with your blood or urine, can be measured by this equipment. Second one, in mechanical or in engineering field, what all the equipments or what all the work pieces can be measured here. The first one, watch gear, what I have displayed here. And the second one, the micro robots. You know, nowadays in the modern day world, operation without using scissors or without opening your heart, you can able to do it with your small tiny nano robots which can swim inside your blood, and with the remote operation, the doctor can able to command the nano robots to swim inside a fat accumulated blood vessels, and which can able to dig inside, clean the vessels, and it will come out effectively. So that nano robots, it will be made by both mechanical engineer as well as electrical engineers. So it's a mix of, you know, two departments together. So they have to stick to the precision, the measurement, how much it should be, how much, without affecting the person, the host who is holding that, the nano robots inside his body, it should not harm to his body. So they have to look into the tolerance and the measurements. So that will be manipulated by this equipment. It can able to measure up to micro and nano level. So first, let us start with this one. Watch gear. So what are the parameters which will be controlling this watch gear? What are the effective parameters I have to identify, how much it should be, then only I can able to go for design of my good watch. Okay, so when you take the watch gear, we have a gear tooth which will be radially seated along your gear blank. So when this gear tooth was revolving, so this will be connected with your tiny motor in your quartz watch, which will be running with your battery powered motor, and the second one will be connected with your hover hand. So the second hand, this will be connected with second hands. Your second will be triggered for every second, so that will be revolving. So for one complete revolution of your second hand, this will make your hover hand to revolve it. I'm sorry, minute hand to revolve it. So 160, one complete revolution of your second hand will trigger your minute hand to make 1 degree revolution. Complete 1 RPM of your second hand will equivalent to 1 degree revolution of your minute hand. So this is how your watch gear is operating here. Now, what are the parameters I'm going to measure it here? First one, we have to measure your major diameter. The major diameter will be calculated from the tip of your gear tooth on one end to the other tip of your gear tooth on the other side. So usually you will call the tip as crest, C-R-E-S-T, crest, or the upper, the hilly area, we call it as crest. Okay, the bottom blunt area or the valley area, we call it as trough, T-R-O-U-G-H, trough. So this will be called as crest and this will be called as trough. So one crest to the other crest, it is called as a major diameter. And one trough, that is your valley area, one valley to the other valley, you can call it as a minor diameter. So how you are going to decide your major diameter? Basically, before designing a watch, if the design engineer giving a command to the manufacturing engineer saying that my watch gear should be between the specification of 15.5 millimeter to 15.8 millimeter, then the manufacturing engineer has to get the values and he should be keen on manufacturing within this range. So before manufacturing it, what he has to do, he should be having a highly precise manufacturing equipment. What do you mean by precise? Precise is the any equipment which can able to reproduce the same measuring values for the multiple iteration. We call it as a precise equipment. Whereas the accurate equipment, accurate is the word which will be fit for any equipment which will provide you the true value or the correct value for only one time. But the same value which will be replicated for multiple number of times, we call that as a precise equipment. Now, how we are going to get the precise values here? So for example, if my design engineer specifies that I should have a major diameter between 15.5 to 15.8, then first, on the first quadrant, if I'm getting 15.65 from the extreme y-axis, negative part of your y-axis to the positive of your y-axis, I'm getting within the range of 15.5 to 15.8, whereas my second quadrant is not obeying my law, it is exceeding my 15.8, then what the manufacturing engineer will do, he will try to reject that or he will try to rework on that to include this watch gear in the acceptable basket. So what I am trying to say that precise means the same measurement should be reflected on all the four quadrants. Only then the manufacturing engineer will be accepting this watch gear to the further process. Otherwise it will be went to the rejection basket or to the rework basket, where the engineers will be redoing the same thing to bring back to the acceptable track. So this is how your process is going to carry on. So the second parameter is between your two troughs which will be seated on both ends. One at your top end, the trough is the valley between your two crest, and the other crest will be exactly opposite to that, and between those two crest, we call that as your minor diameter. And the third parameter, it's called as a pitch circle diameter. What do you mean by PCD, pitch circle diameter? Pitch circle diameter is it's a imaginary circle which will be running along your gear tooth, but it will be running at the half of your gear tooth height. What is the use of that? Gear tooth height will be deciding how much height it has to leap forward or rather leap high, and how much height it has to dig down in the bottom. So this is like a median of your gear tooth ups and downs. So pitch circle diameter, usually, you know, it's like an imaginary circle. So based on that, we'll say what is your gear tooth height and gear tooth depth. Height is the one which will be visible above your pitch circle, and gear tooth depth is the one which will be coming below your pitch circle. So that will be identified by this equipment. And the last one will be your collinearity. That means, you know, your center of your driving gear should be aligned with your driven gear. These two centers should be collinear. Only then you can able to transfer the motion equally, or rather at least in the calculated state. Otherwise, what will happen? The transferring loss will be there. You know, the amount of energy which will be given to the driver gear will not be exactly transferred if it is not placed in the collinear point. That means the two center points should be lying on the same line. That point we call it as a collinear. Now we'll start our measurement here. First, I will tell you the way of measuring it. We have a white, you know, the round illuminating measurement table. We call that as your projector screen. Okay, so how I'm going to start my screen? Before I'm going to do that, I have to do the calibration. What do you mean by calibration? I have to align my X and Y axis with a predefined mark which was given by the manufacturer. Here he had made a small intersection mark, so which specifies that this was the manufacturer's x-axis aligning point. So what I have to do, I have to use my revolving screw to align my x-axis with this intersection. Then after you fix it down, don't forget to lock it down. This screw is called as a locking screw. If you fail to do it, what will happen? When you are operating on the screen, your hand will, you know, able to move it without your knowledge. So instead of having that trouble, you can able to lock this. That will able to fix your screen exactly on the intersection point. Okay, so now what I'm going to do, I'm going to bring my bottom off of my screw, I mean gear tooth, exactly to the intersection of X and Y axis here, and I'm going to make this point as my user defined origin point. What do you mean by that? I can fix any point of my gear tooth as origin and the next point as the excited point. So from this point I'm going to start my measurement. So I'm going to keep this point as the origin. So press the large button here, we call this as the origin point. Press this for one time, so this y axis will be made as zero. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to move my y axis to the opposite side. So move it slowly to reach the counterpart of your the aligned gear, and you will be reaching at the top of your gear tooth. And once you reach your tip of your gear tooth at the opposite side, stop there and find your measurement, 9.258, and it was followed by a negative symbol. What is the meaning of a negative symbol? Machine knows that the bottom half is the negative half of your y-axis and the top half of is a positive half of your y-axis. So when you move from negative half to the positive half, the machine will denote with the minus symbol. But how to, you know, avoid the confusion here? You can eliminate the symbol and take the modulus of this value. So minus is just for, you know, telling you that you started your measurement from the negative y-axis to the positive y-axis, but otherwise you don't carry any significance here. So your measurement is exactly 9.258. now what is the next step I'm going to do? I should not believe the value for one iteration, or rather I should not convinced with one iteration. So what I have to do, I have to go for the second quadrant. So now I'm going to start with my x-axis quadrant here. So what I'm going to do, move my x-axis screw gauge here and go and align your x-axis with your origin here. So I'm exactly taking the gear tooth tip here and aligning with my x-axis origin. So this one I have to define the system, or rather educate my instrument saying that this is my origin. So I have to press my zero here, and I'm telling to the system that you have to start your measurement for this quadrant from this point. Then I have to move my screw gauge to capture the x-axis major diameter. So what is the value it was displaying here? It was showing that 9.219, whereas in the y-axis we got it as 9.258, whereas the x-axis is 9.219. So what is the understanding behind these two different values? It says that each quadrant will have different values. Then how I'm going to revolve, or rather how I'm going to have the accurate time in my watch? So they will set you the range. Within that range, if it falls, then it will be accepted. So here, if suppose it is, if this 9.219 is within the acceptable range specified by your design engineer, then it is right. And how long I have to take this kind of measurement? I have to take for minimum 4 iterations. So next time what I'm going to do, take your hand there and slightly revolve it to the opposite quadrants, because we have a fixed x-axis and y-axis. We cannot revolve it to the alternate angles on the angular direction. So you can able to revolve it slightly and bring the unmeasured area to the x and y-axis. Repeat the same process again. Go for the y-axis measurement and fix your origin here and do the measurement here. Press this and make it a 0 here. Go for the opposite side. So I'm getting 9.192. So this is for your third quadrant. Fourth quadrant, how am I going to do? Go for the right extreme of your x-axis. Again, redo the same process again, and you will be getting your fourth quadrant value. And fix this as a origin here. Make this as a origin here. Press it and make it a 0 in the x-axis. Revolve it to the opposite value, opposite gear tooth height, and you can able to get the value for that also. It is around 9.234. Now I got that 4 values from the 4 quadrant measurement. What I'm going to do, I should not conclude with any one of the value, but rather I have to take an average of all these 4. That will help me to identify what is my mean major diameter for my gear tooth. That is my first parameter calculation. So we'll go for the second parameter calculation. I've told you that mean diameter, it is the distance between two valleys. We call that as a trough. Between these two values, we are going to measure it. The same procedure what we followed in the first parameter measurement, that will be reciprocated on the second parameter measurement also. So same way, align your center point here, capture your the symmetrical workpiece here and go to the bottom half. And now instead of capturing your tip here, you can go to the any one of your valley here. So that value what I told you, that was named as trough, T-R-O-U-G-H. Okay, so now I captured the trough here, make it a 0 and revolve it to the opposite trough. Opposite trough here, and that will help you to identify what is your minor diameter. So minor diameter is around 8.488 for the first quadrant. The same way I have to reciprocate or redo the same process for the another 4 quadrants. So I have told you how to measure your major diameter, how to told you the minor diameter. Now the third one we are going to find out, what is the third parameter? We call that as a pitch circle diameter. What is pitch circle diameter? The pitch circle is our imaginary circle which will be running along your gear tooth, but exactly at the half of your gear tooth height. That will not be seen physically, but you can able to feel virtually. So we have to capture it, where it starts and where it ends. So here both starting and ending point is invisible. So what I'm going to do, we need one more gear called as a mating gear that will be seated exactly at a specific point. We call that as a pitch point. That pitch point or the pressure point is the one which will be exactly seated at the pitch circle direction. So with that we can able to identify where your pitch circle is. Say for example, if you take all these 3 gears, the top gear we call it as a disengaging gear. That means when you revolve your gear on clockwise direction, so the gear which was moving out of your engagement, we call it as a disengaging gear. The gear which was coming inside, we call it as an engaging gear. The gear which was exactly seated at the center, we call it as a perfectly seated gear. So this one gear is responsible for entire motion. This same gear principles will be applicable even for pulling your huge lorries which will be taking 10 or 15 tons on their rear end. So the gears are more important for making a mechanism to be more dynamic. So what are the 3 gears I've told you? First one is your disengaging gear which is moving out of your coupling, And the counterpart is your encasing gear, which is coming inside your encasement. We call that as your encasing gear. And the third one, which is exactly at the center, we call it as a perfectly seated gear. And perfectly seated gear tooth is responsible for entire motion. If this gear tooth is having some linearity or some eccentricity inside, then your entire motion will not have a smooth riding, whereas it has some vibration in the during the transfer of your motion. So now how you are going to measure your pitch circle diameter, directly go to the perfectly seated gear here, and that will be having a point contact. If you take that gear here, it will be seated on a small point here. It won't have a line contact, whereas it is having a point contact. That point is responsible for transferring the motion from the driver gear to the driven gear. So that point we call it as a pressure point or pitch point. From that point towards the center, we call it as a pitch circle radius, and multiply this linear distance, we call it as pitch circle diameter. So I'll do the small demonstration how to measure it. First one, I have captured this point. It is seated at the exactly at the point, small point. So I have to identify this point. Here comes your entire scale. If you fail to do that, then your entire measurement will be end up in failure. So I have to capture that point, make this as zero, because I'm going to move it on the x-axis. I have to press my zero on the x-axis caliper. So after that, move it towards your center here. So after you move it towards the center, I'm going to fix my center, but I don't know whether this center is the exact center or assumed center of mine. From my perspective, I believe this as the center. So how I have to conclude with the exact center point? So how I'm going to do that? So I have to take it in the four different directions, take an average of it, then you will capture the exact center, and then we are going to the further measurement. So first measurement, I'm going to start from this point towards the center. So I'm getting the value as 4.459. Ignore your negative value and only take the numerical value. So it's around 4.459. It is the distance of your pitch circle radius. For my pitch circle diameter, I have to multiply this value. Then that will be exactly reflected to the other half also. I will be getting a pitch circle diameter. Instead of PCR, two times of your PCR will be PCD, pitch circle diameter. So first half is over. Now we'll go, we are aligning with the center. But this center may not be the exact center. So to avoid the bias in the user judgment on the center, what I have to do? I have to take the values on four quadrants to avoid the bias in my perspective, because I'm standing adjacent to that and I'm looking with a different perspective. But with the user who is opposite to this view, will be getting exact center. So I should not conclude with the one iteration. So I'm going for the second iteration. So what I'm going to do, take my smaller gear and go to the opposite quadrant here. And now you have to do the same process for pitch circle diameter calculation here. So I told you that three sets of gears will be there. One is a disencasing. The center one will be your, this is your disencasing gear. The center one will be your perfectly seated gear. And the third one will be your encasing gear. So your value will be start from your perfectly seated gear. Move your origin towards your perfectly seated gear here. Yeah. So I told you that, that these two gears will be seated on a point contact rather than line contact. So I have to capture that point. How I'm going to identify the point? When any two points are, seated on the, or rather aligned together, the remaining area will be allowing the light to pass through it. So this is the way to identify your point. Telling you again, when you want to identify your point contact, when you see the, picture with the closer shot, these two tooths will be seated on a specific point where the light will not be passing through that point. Remaining, adjacent to the point on top side and the bottom side will be permitting your light from the background to pass through that. So we can identify the point easily where the intersection point of these two gears are. That point I told you as pitch point or your pressure point. So aligning your tooth on the point, we call that as your pressure point, and make this point as zero here. So how to press that? Press the zero, the larger one, and make it as zero here. So I'm pressing it zero here. Now the zero was reflected on the y-axis table here. Okay. So what is the next step here? Revolve your axis slowly towards your center. So I'm revolving it, and I'm going to reach a specific line, and I assume with my perspective this seems to be the center. Okay, so what is the value I'm getting? It 4.867. previous time I'm getting different value, now I'm getting the different value. So the third one, I'm going to the next quadrant, taking my smaller gear and going to align with your third quadrant. So make it slowly and don't disturb the larger gear too much. Okay, yeah, so we have seated the smaller gear on the third quadrant. Now what I'm going to do, my next one is to identify my pressure point. So out of these three gears, I can say this as the disengaging gear, this as the engaging gear, and the third one is your engaging gear. So I'm again kind of telling you, the one which is at the top, we call it as a disengaging. When it revolves in the clockwise, whatever comes at the top, we call it as disengaging gear. And the second gear is a perfectly seated gear, and the third one is the approaching gear or the going to engage, we call that as engaging gear. So I have to capture the center one, which is called as a perfectly seated gear. So take the perfectly seated gear and identify the point on which it has a contact. So point of contact point, and make that as zero here. Press the x axis because it is going to move along your x axis axis. So I make this as zero, and from this point, from this initial point towards your center, we have to move. So I am revolving my caliper slowly on the anti-clockwise way, so it will help you to move towards your center. So I am moving it towards your center. By the time I reach the center, I have to stop my revolving and I will get the value 4.464. On the last quadrant, we are going to move now. Take your gear slowly and you can able to fix it down as the fourth quadrant. So I'm going to fix it down here. I've fixed it down. Now what we have to do, the same process what we did for the other three quadrants should be reflected on the fourth quadrant. So move it down here, and now I have to identify a pressure point here. So pressure point will be at the center gear, so I have to identify that, and this point will be my pressure point or the pitch point. So from this point you have to start your value. Press your zero button here, press it down, and this time you have to measure it along your y axis, not on the x axis. So I have to take my zero from your y axis caliper and revolve it slowly towards your center. So my zero was reached down here and I have to stop my revolving. I'm getting the value as 4.492. so I have did for four quadrants for my pitch circle diameter. So what I have to do, take an average of all these four. That will be helpful to tell you what is the correct value for your pitch circle diameter. Don't conclude with one iteration. That will provide a lot of bias in the user judgment. User judgment will be variable based on the eyesight of the user. Sometimes the user will have a very clear eyesight and he can able to judge it properly. But if suppose the same user who is having a poor eyesight will not able to judge properly. And the second one, user will also have parallax error. What is a parallax error? If the person was standing just adjacent to the equipment with a slight inclination, then that will provide a different perspective rather than person who is standing exactly parallel to the equipment face to face, and that will provide a different perspective. So parallax error also should be avoided. So before you start your equipment, you should educate your user how to avoid these kind of errors. One is your proper judgmental error, and second one is your parallax error. The based on your viewing capability, the parallax error will also have different values. Now the fourth parameter we are going to measure, that is slightly different from the other process what we learned so far. So all the three what we learned so far, the major diameter, minor diameter, pitch circle diameter, will be understood or rather measured by using your linear measurement, x axis and y axis. Now we are slightly, you know, going to use the different display column here. We call that as your angular measurement. What is the use of angular measurement? It can able to tell you what is the inclination of your teeth. If your teeth was having an acute angle very closely, you know, with less than say 45 degree, then that will be helpful for transferring your motion very easily. What happen if I have the broader angle above 60 degree or 70 degree, then your gears will be looking blunt and that will create a lot of noise when it was revolving. That's why, you know, when you see the, you know, heavy wheelers, when you shift your gear from the lower order, that means from your first gear to second gear, and if the gear tooth is not properly inclined with the acute angle, then the transferring motion will be having a lot of wobbling noise. How to avoid that? Either you have to go for replacement of gears with acute angle, or rather you have to go for high amount of lubrication. How to do that? Immerse your gears inside a gearbox filled with huge amount of white oil, we call it as a SAE 33 oil, that will reduce your noise to the meager extent. So this is how you can able to control your transferring loss motion. When you transfer the gear motion from driver gear to driven gear, this gear angle is responsible for transferring your entire motion, or at least 80% of your transferring RPM to the other driven gear. If it is not so, then your transferring loss will be massive and you have to face the loss out of this mechanism. So that's why we are measuring your angle of your gear tooth. How to measure that? Now you can remove your mating gear slightly far away from the scope, and you have to project your screen only on driver gear. I'm going to select any one of the gear tooth, either from top or the bottom. So I'm going to pick one gear tooth from here, from the bottom half, and fix it down here. Now what I'm going to do, take your locking screw, unlock the locking screw slowly so that you can able to shift your coordinate axis based on your inclination of your gear tooth. So I'm going to revolve the unlock screw and take your revolving screw and align with any one of your gear tooth sides. So I have picked out the bottom screw here, bottom gear tooth, and aligning my Y axis with the inclined point of my gear tooth. So I have captured one side. Now what I have to do? I have to make this point as zero, this point as origin point. So what I have to do? Press the zero here. So if the zero is not shifted, what is the meaning here? It was kept in the absolute mode. What do you mean by absolute mode? Absolute mode is the manufacturer defined origin. So manufacturer has educated this system to take only a certain point as the origin. It won't take the user defined origin. So user is not having any option to take the random points as the origin. So how I am going to shift this point as the origin? I have to toggle this from absolute mode to the incremental mode. So incremental mode, you know, allow the user to take any point in the graphical area as the origin. So make it as incremental mode. Now you can go for the zero, press it down. So I can capture this point as a zero. So from this angle, zero angle, to the adjacent side angle, I'm going to measure it. So what I have to do? I have to move two screws parallelly. What is that? One is your revolving screw, which is on the screen, and the second one is your x-axis caliper. Why I have to move? Because I have to move my axis, y-axis, parallelly. I have to move my caliper to move the screw linearly. Okay, so I have to move parallelly both screws. So you know, you have to take a lot of effort, as well as, you know, slowly you have to do it, otherwise your reading will not be captured accurately. So I'm moving it, I'm taking the adjacent point of my specified gear tooth. I have now aligned my same Y axis, which is at the opposite side, which was revolved to the extreme opposite side now. Okay, so the distance between two inclined sides of my gear, I'm going to measure it down. So that will be reflected here. So what is the value I'm getting it here? 34 degree and 3 minutes. We know that each degree will be subdivided into 60 minutes, and again the each minute will be subdivided into 60 seconds. So the entire degree, the 34 degree, what is the meaning of it? Each time when it crosses the 60, it will be count up with one more value. Say for example, 60 minutes it reached here, it won't have 61 first minute, it will be changed into first minute again. So after it reaches 60, this count will be higher up by, increased by one count. That means 34 degree will be changed to 35 once in every 60 minutes. Okay, so this is how we are going to measure. So 34 degree, 3 minutes, now it is measured. So whether you can able to conclude your measurement with that? No, you have to go for multiple measurement. How I'm going to do that? pick any one of the teeth on other quadrant. Say for example, first quadrant I have selected now. You can also try with second quadrant, third quadrant and fourth quadrant gear tooth. Repeat the same process, take an average of it, and you can able to get the average gear tooth angle, inclined angle. So that angle, I've told you, that is responsible for having a smooth motion between driving and driven gear. With this, I'll conclude with profile projector equipment for how to measure your gear tooth. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you have any doubts, you can able to read through the manual and you can able to understand the further measurements. Thank you.